The topic which we shall continue today is the topic which we were discussing in the previous day, that of the entity relationship model. We shall review the entity relationship model quickly, and we shall find out some of the extended features which are available in this model for modeling situations which are normally not there, normally not studied in pure entities and relationships. And then we will relate it to the relational model which we saw earlier as being expressed as the information being expressed in a set of tables or relations. So we saw that the entity relationship model consists of two types of concepts, one the entities and the other the relationships, and both the entities and the relationships have got some attributes. These attributes define the particular entity, and these attributes define the particular relationship. Moreover, we saw that relationships need not be only between two entities. Relationships can be there between more than two entities. And an example which we saw was accounts, customers, and branches was a ternary relationship between three entities. Relationships can also occur between entities of the same type. That is, there may be a relationship with the same entity. An example which we saw was the manager-worker relationship, where the same entity was involved in a relationship with itself. There we express the role separately for each of these linkages. We discussed in details the difference between modeling an entity with a set of attributes and when we shall break up an entity into a relationship, the reasons for doing so and why, and what is the actual difference between one entity and a set of attributes being replaced by two entities and a relationship. We saw the phones example and we saw several other examples. Next, we saw the mapping constraints, in which we discussed that we can express the constraints in the relationships, whether it is a one-one, one-many, many-many, or a many-one relationship. And that we were doing by marking the arrows in a particular direction. For example, if we mark this arrow, we said that this staff can participate in a one many or a one one relationship with phones. If this arrow is there, then phones can participate in a one many or a one one relationship with staff. Both the arrows signify that this is a one one relationship with itself. Other than this mapping constraint, we saw the issue of surjection, where we discussed existence dependencies, and we said that a dependency is said to be existence, a relationship with an entity is said to be existent dependent on another entity, provided that it is surjective in the sense that each and every element of this entity set must have a mapping with an element in this entity set. For example, if we mark this arrow along with this entity, which we call a weak entity, and this one we call a strong entity, then together we have, this is a one-to-many or a one-to-one relationship, and this is a many-many or a many-one relationship. Together it signifies that a customer can have more than one account, and every account must belong to exactly one customer. And this signifies that account is existence dependent on customer. Therefore, whatever is the account, that must correspond to a particular customer. There cannot be any account without any customer. However, there can be a customer who does not have any account. Regarding the attributes, we found out that all the attributes may not be required to define uniquely what a particular entity in an entity set is. If a subset of the attributes can define uniquely what an entity is, then it is called a super key. A minimal subset of a super key is called a candidate key, and the database designer selects from the candidate keys the primary key of the database. Now we move on to another concept called the concept of generalization. Consider a ticket. Now, a ticket in a railway reservation system may have several attributes. One is ticket number. Another is start, destination. And let us say it also has a fare, and it also there is a distance. So this is a ticket, but now we want to differentiate between a reserved ticket and an unreserved ticket. We also want to differentiate between an express ticket and a local ticket. Now we can do it in many ways. For example, differentiating between a reserved ticket and an unreserved ticket, we may put a key reserved or unreserved. Now if it is unreserved, you will have a value U. If it is reserved, you will have a value R. But this does not suffice, because a reserved ticket will have the reservation, which train it is reserved, what is the seat number allocated to it, what is the fare extra reservation charge which is charged for it, which an ordinary ticket will not have. Whereas now we would also like to differentiate between whether it is an express ticket or a local ticket. That we may be able to do here with the fare difference and express ticket or a local ticket here, whether we are going to allow it on an express train or a local train. But for reserved and unreserved, we will see that if it is a reserved ticket, we will have certain attributes. If it is an unreserved ticket, we will have certain other attributes. Now for that, we can have two entities themselves. One is a reserved ticket entity, one is an unreserved ticket entity. But conceptually, it is a ticket and a lot of its attributes will be common. For that, the ER diagram provides some extensional features for modeling such issues. What we do is, we have a ticket. And we have what is called an is a relationship. A typical is a relationship is indicated by this link. So we say a ticket can be a reserved ticket or an unreserved ticket. Now this is the common ticket, and it can have two types of special cases. So reserved ticket is a specialization of a ticket. Unreserved ticket is another specialization of a ticket. And we can also say that ticket is a generalization of reserved ticket. Unreserved ticket, ticket is also a generalization of an unreserved ticket. Now regarding the attributes. The common attributes will be put here. The separate attributes will be put here. So the common attributes can be and the distinct other attributes which will be here is seat number, train number, reservation up to, and so on. For an unreserved ticket, you can have certain attributes for an unreserved ticket as well, which is different from a reserved ticket. And for that, for example, a reserved ticket, let us say we have reserved tickets only for express trains. We do not allow reserved tickets for a local train. So here we may have an attribute whether it is local or express. Therefore, the fare for a reserved ticket will be here, and a fare for an unreserved ticket will be different here. So now the attributes of a reserved ticket are the attributes here and the attributes of its generalization put together. The attributes of an unreserved ticket are the attributes of itself and the attributes of its generalization. This is how we model generalizations, concepts which have got subparts or subconcepts. And this set of attributes is said to be inherited by its special case. These attributes are inherited by its special case. Therefore, the attributes of a reserved ticket are 4 plus 4, 8 attributes are there, whereas an attribute of an unreserved ticket are 4 and 2, 6 attributes are there. So we keep the common part in one place and the special parts in another place. We come to the next issue, and that is called one of aggregation. Let us consider the following example. We have a set of teachers which forms one entity set. We have a set of subjects which forms another entity set. And we have a relationship teachers, that is, this teacher teaches this subject. Let us put in some attributes for these teachers and their subjects. let us put some attributes for a subject. It is a subject code, a title, and whether it is UG or PG. And this teacher teaches this subject. Okay. Another thing which we may put on this subject is the LTP loading for this subject. Now we want to model the following problem. We want to model the set of books used by a teacher to teach a subject. Now, how will we do that? We can have a relationship, we will have the entity set book. Obviously, we will have the entity set book and its attributes, which I am not writing, and we will have a relationship uses we will say this teacher for this subject uses this book. So, this is a mapping saying that the teacher uses this book for this subject, and we may have, since a teacher may use more than one book for a particular subject, we may have a category, an attribute of this relationship, whether it is a reference book or a textbook. That is, whether it is a textbook which he is going to regularly follow, or it's a reference book which can be occasionally seen. Now, we have got a teacher-teacher subjects relationship, and we have got a teacher uses this book. Conceptually, there are certain problems in having both of them here. The problem is that when we have got one, actually, we are trying to model a relationship with the teacher teaching a subject and the book. We have already got a relationship, teacher teaches this subject, and our attempt is to relate that subject which is taught by this teacher with the book. So, what we have done is we have taken this and this separately. We have got one teacher uses these subjects for the book, and we have got a teacher teaches these subjects. Our actual intention was to have a relationship between this relation and this book. That is why we have done this. But if we look at what we wanted to do, we wanted to have a relationship between this relation and this book. Now, we normally do not allow relationships between relations and entities, or relations and relations. Therefore, we are forced to do this. But if we look deeply, we can see that an entity is comprised of a set of attributes, another entity is comprised of another set of attributes. A relationship is comprising of a set of attributes also. It is the participating attributes of these two. Therefore, we can look at the teacher teaching a course as an aggregate entity of like this. This is a bigger entity consisting of teachers teaching this course. And this entity has got these attributes and this relationship. Therefore, this larger entity is said to be an aggregate of this entity and its relationship. And what we will do is, we will model this aggregate and look at it as an aggregated entity and relate this uses with this aggregated entity. So this is the aggregate of this. It consists of, from the outside, it will look like an one entity, which is the teachers, teaches these subjects. This relationship forms an aggregate of this entity. These three together form one aggregate, which consists of these attributes and this relationship. So you can look at it as an aggregated entity, and we can say that for this part, we want, for each of these courses, we want to find out those teachers who uses this book. Because otherwise, here, in this particular situation, this teacher uses this book. We can have a relation that a teacher uses a particular book for a particular subject, and yet we may not have that relation teacher teaches this subject. If we allow what we did normally, like this, then what we can have is that a teacher teaches a particular subject, and we can have a teacher who does not teach this subject, that is, a teacher X and a subject Y are not related by this teacher's relationship, but we can have teacher uses for that same subject a particular book. Now, this is not what we wanted to model. This is not what we wanted to model. What we wanted to model was, if the teacher teaches this book, what he uses? What is the, if the teacher teaches this subject, what is the book that the teacher uses? And that is not modeled accurately by this scheme. It is modeled better using this aggregated scheme. Another way to look at aggregation is the concept of structures. You know, structures are nested structures in any data structuring problem. You have a structure, and inside that structure you can have other structures. You can have many other internal nested structures. So aggregation is just like a nested structure. You combine a portion of the ER diagram and look at it as one whole entity. So now here, it is only those teachers who teach these subjects, only they, whether they use this book or not is mapped here. So aggregation allows us to model relationships with relationships.
Is it possible to represent
the type of relationship will always be modeled. See, if I write this, then what does it mean? Now, if I want to put mapping constraints, the question asked was whether we can model the type of relationship or the mapping constraints. So if I put this link, then it means that this participates in a one-many or a one-one with this. So a particular teacher can use a book if we write it like this, and this book cannot be used by another teacher who is teaching this subject, who is teaching another subject. It is actually a mapping with this relation back here. You look at it as one whole entity. You can put all the mapping constraints, the weak entities, strong entities, everything comes here. The attributes of the aggregate in this particular case will be the attributes of teacher, the attributes of subjects and teachers. All the attributes together will form the attributes of this aggregate.
What happens to the teachers who are not teaching any subject?
The teachers who are not teaching any subject, they are modeled as in the teacher's set. Subjects which are not taught by any teacher or not being offered in this particular situation, they are modeled here. And only those who are teaching this subject are modeled here. Therefore, this aggregation is the teacher, subject and the teachers. Only those will be modeled in this aggregation, not the teachers individually. If I want to find out whether the teacher has studied this book, independent of whether the teacher teaches this book, or if I want to model if the teacher has a copy of this book, then I will this means that this teacher has a copy of this book, whereas this block means that this teacher for this course, when the teacher teaches this course, he uses this book. That is the difference. Now we come to the how we will look at it from the relational model point of view. We saw when we discussed very early what is a relational model, we saw that the relational model consists of a set of tables. In these tables have got several columns corresponding to the attributes. For book, we will have columns corresponding to the attributes of the book. User will have columns corresponding to attributes of user, and borrowed by will have columns corresponding to the attributes of the book user relationship modeled by the borrowed by relationship. We will quickly see how a relational model, the tables of a relational model, can be obtained from the entity relationship diagrams that we can draw. Now let us go through them one by one. For every entity set, we have one table, and for that table, the columns correspond to the attributes of this entity set. For every entity set users, we have one table corresponding to the attributes, and the columns will correspond to the attributes of this entity set. For the borrowed by relationship, we will have another table. Now, for that table, what will be the attributes of that table? If we are not told anything about the constraints. So let us take the example like this. So we have got the book entity, the user's entity, and the borrowed by relationship. We have got a table for book with its attributes. We have got a table for users with its attributes. Now we want a table for the borrowed by relationship. Now what will be the attributes? One of the attributes will definitely be the attribute of this relationship, the date of issue. And we said earlier that all the attributes of this and all the attributes of this will be there. That is the worst case scenario. But we can use the primary keys to reduce the size of this table for a relationship. For example, in a book, we had the primary key accession number. In users, we had the primary key card number. So now in the borrowed by relationship, we can map, if we have the accession number of any book, we know the book uniquely. If we have the card number of any user, we know all the attributes of the user by looking up the user table. So we need not keep in the borrowed by table, we need not keep all the attributes. We can keep only the prime attribute here and the prime attribute here. So here we will only have accession number and we will only have card number, and the rest is not required. So using the primary keys of a relationship, we can reduce the size of a table, we can generate the table of any ER relation. Now, will this table change if we have this? The question is, if we now have mapping constraints, if we now have mapping constraints, that is, this one is a one to many relationship. This is a one to many relationship. Then how will we model this one? Is there anything we can do about it? Can we reduce any of these entries? Or if it is a one to one relationship? We cannot reduce any of these entries because book may be related to somebody else. But if this is the only thing that we had, so what are the things we can do? In this table, we must keep these three attributes. In the borrowed by table, we must keep these three attributes. If we don't keep these three attributes, then we will lose the information itself. We know that if it is a one-one relationship, then for the same accession number, there will be only one entry here. And for the same card number, there will be only one entry here. That's all. Some people may be interested in trying to say that if it is a one-one relationship, then why shouldn't we club all three together and have only one table? That is, we don't have a separate table for book. We don't have a separate table for users. We don't have a separate table for borrowed by. We have only one table because for every book there must be a user. That is not true. Some books may have no users. That is why we cannot club them up together and put them into one table. But we can use this idea in another situation. Let us say we have got let us say we have got this ER diagram. In this ER diagram, we have got a strong entity X. And a weak entity Y. Now, weak entity is a weak entity means that every element here must have a corresponding entry here in this relationship. That is, there cannot be any element in Y which is not related to X. It is a weak entity of X. And we have put this link saying that there is a 1, 2, even if we did not put this link, it is not a problem. But suppose we have put this link, it is a 1 to many relationship. Now what we can do is, instead of having three tables, one for X, one for Y, and one for the relation XY, sorry, we can have only two tables, one table for X and another table for these two and another table just for these two. These two will give one table and this will lead to one table, because this table will be required because some people may have no element here. Therefore, we cannot club these two tables together to form one table. Then we will have null values. The attributes of this table will be the attributes of X. The attributes of this table will be the attributes of Y and this together, XY and Y together. The attributes of XY will be the primary key of this, and it's a weak entity, it may have no primary key. So all the attributes. So all the attributes of Y, the attributes of this, and the attributes of this will be the attributes of this table. And we can convert it just to two tables instead of three tables in case of a weak entity. Now let us come to aggregation. Let us come to generalization. It's easier to tackle that first. Yes. There are two ways in which we can implement this. One is the use of variant records. We define this whole structure to be one variant record, which can be either of this type or let us make P, Q, R. We can implement it by one variant record. So variant record structure of a table can be used to implement this. In a variant record structure, we will have one structure containing these, and the rest of it may contain these three or these two. This is the variant record structure which you have. The other alternative is two table structure in which in one table you have got STU PQR and in another table you have got STU VW. So we can represent it hierarchically by the variant record structure, or we can represent it as a flat table by a two table structure. So once we have done the conceptual modeling using the entity relationship model, next we will set up the database scheme. So given an entity relationship model, the next stage is to set up the database scheme. We know what are the constraints, we know exactly what each and every item are. So the next stage after getting the entity relationship model is to set up the database scheme. So suppose we have got book, user, supplier and two relations supplied by and borrowed by, and each of them will have some attributes, accession number, title, year of publication, supplier will supply date of supply and the price. A supplier will have S name and address. Borrowed by will have date of issue, will have card number, name, address. Let us make a simple example. For this now we will have 5 tables and we will put in some constraints. One of the simplest constraints that we will put in is one book can be borrowed by only one user. So this constraint will be there. That is, one book, a user can borrow more than one book, but that book can be borrowed by one user only. You cannot have a shared issue. So now we will have five relation schemes be corresponding to the 5 tables. So when we set up the database scheme for this example, we will have 5 relation schemes. So we will have the book scheme, which will have the attributes accession number, year, title. We will have the user scheme, which will have card number, name, address. We will have the supplier scheme, which will have S name and S address. We will have separate names for all these attributes. If we will not have the same name, see, this is a name, this is a name. But we will have two different identifiers for these two names because they are two different names. And we will give the type of each of these also. That I have not mentioned here. So for the 3 entities, we will have 3 schemes. And if this is the primary key here, and this is the primary key here, then for the borrowed by relationship, we will have one scheme called the borrowed by scheme. Which will have three attributes, the accession number, because this is the primary key here, this is the primary key here, and say this is the primary key here. Then this will be accession number, card number, and date of issue. Similarly, the supplied by scheme will be between the book and the supplier. So it will have accession number, price, date of supply, and supplier name. So this is the scheme definition. This is like the type definition. And now we will have the database definition or the instance definition. This is the scheme definition, and now we will have the instance definition. Book of type book scheme. User of type user scheme. Supplier of type supplier scheme, borrowed of type borrowed by scheme, and supplied of type supplied by. We have got book, user, supplied by, supplier, and for all of these five, we have got five database schemes. For book, we have identified the primary keys. For borrowed by, can we have any primary key for borrowed by? Borrowed by is known to be having this constraint. So if it has this constraint, the primary key of the borrowed by relationship can be the primary key of book and its attribute DOI. Accession number and date of issue will uniquely give you the user, because one book can be borrowed by only one user. Therefore, since one book can be borrowed by only one user, accession number and date of issue will give you the unique card number. There cannot be in the borrowed by scheme or in the borrowed relation, any instance of the borrowed relation, there cannot be two books which have the same accession number and the same date of issue and different card numbers. It can have the same accession number, different date of issue and different card number, because a person may have issued this book many times if we model that. But if we model only current status, then this and this uniquely give this. So this is how we have said that this is the primary key of this. Whereas the supplied by relationship does not have any constraints. And it's a many, many relationship out here. If it is a many, many relationship out here, then there will be no, all of them together will form the primary key. But if you put in the constraint that a particular book which has a particular accession number can be supplied by only one supplier, then immediately we will get accession number, price, date of supply to form the key to this scheme. So now we have modeled everything as tables. Everything looks identical, though we conceived of them differently when we did our conceptual modeling. When we came to the relational scheme, we model them all as relations. So we started with a conceptual scheme, we understood why we did that, we put in all our constraints, and then we developed what is called the relational database scheme, and for a particular situation we did got some instance. Now for this instance we will possibly fill up some data and we will have our database. Now after we have our database, the next phase which we will have is how to find out from this database various questions, how to give questions to this database and how to get answers. Who has issued a particular book? What is the year of publication of this book? Who is the author of this book? How many books are there of this title in the library? Have I issued any book which has been supplied by Narosa Publications? So after having gone through the database scheme and definition part of the database design, we come to the next place. So when we look at the original database model, we have come to the design of the database scheme. We will then compile it and it will form the data dictionary. In order to write programs, we have to know a language in which to write programs on this database. How to efficiently write programs in a manner which is more high level than a normal programming language. For this, we will have to understand what is meant by a query. There are various mathematical techniques to know what is a query, and we will tackle this in the next lecture.